in verse 29 of Matthew 24, immediately after the tribulation of those days, remember that general tribulation time, now we're talking about the great tribulation time, immediately after the tribulation of those days, then what does the scripture say? Shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds. Here's his clouds. Okay, we're getting there. And here's the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And verse 31, now we see, because remember we just read in verse 29, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the days that preceded, right? Then the sun will be darkened, the moon will be darkened, the heavens have power, the earth will be shaken. And what does it say now? Now it says the clouds, and then in verse 31, and he shall send his angels. Here are those angels again. First, we talked about the archangel in 1 Thessalonians 4, right? But now we hear that there are more angels. He shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, you know, all over the earth, north, south, east, and west. From the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So clearly, this first part of the regular tribulation is not when we're meeting the Lord in the air. It is only, what does he say? After. Immediately after that regular tribulation. How do we know that that was different? Because now the sun is darkened, the moon is darkened, the heavens are being shaken. There's a trumpet, clouds, the Lord is coming. Unmistakable, different, distinct and different from the other parts that he was describing. Those birth pangs, the beginning of sorrows, right? So a lot of what we have been seeing, the signs of what we, earthquakes, remember he said, there's going to be earthquakes, famines, right? All of this stuff is going to be happening. But that's just the usual, right? And even now, you can hear people, even in conversation, saying, well, you know, we've always had earthquakes, right? We've always had floods. We've always had disasters. There's always been famines, right? What makes it different now? Because it's the great tribulation. How do we know the great tribulation has occurred? Things are happening that are different. And it's not until after this great tribulation, that the trumpet sounds and we see the Lord in the clouds. And we know that this is different also from the latter part spoken of in Revelation 19, where the Lord comes on the white horse. Because here we're not being told about a white horse. Right? So we get details continually more and more and more in depth. But we, I wanted to just point that, to bring that up because, you know, of course, many people have been asking, many comments, and of course, this is, you know, an area that people will want to argue about. You listen, it's not necessary to argue about it. Just go to the Word of God. Let the Holy Spirit reveal it to you, and the Lord will reveal the truth to you in your spirit, and you will be able to understand. No need to argue. You know, at the end of the day, whether you believe that the rapture comes before, you know, the tribulations, the great tribulation, right? Which would be like now, right? Because we're not experiencing great tribulation. I mean, we have tribulation, that common ordinary tribulation, right? The suffering of the saints, diseases, you know, sickness, famines, pestilence. That's the ordinary. Because God said, Jesus said, it's going to be such that we have not seen. Such that we have not seen. The Great Tribulation is marked by some of those same kinds of experiences that we have not seen or experienced before. So clearly, it is distinct and separate away from those ordinary times, those days, right? So we don't need to argue. Whether it's then or there, I just hope that you see the signs. Because you don't want to be deceived, right? Remember, that's the way Jesus started out. Do not be deceived. Do not be deceived. So it is important that you read the word, study the word, and pray throughout for direction and edification from the Holy Spirit on what is truth. Because remember that the Lord said also in Matthew 24, when you start seeing some of these things, don't run here and there. Don't follow the people who say, go this way, go that way. The Christ is over here, Christ is over there, so forth and so on. Because he doesn't want you to be deceived. He's telling you clearly what you shall see at that time. What to look for. This is why, you know, it's not about studying signs so that we can make predictions. This is about studying the signs of the heavens and studying the word of God so that we are not deceived. And therefore, by not being deceived, we don't deceive others. Amen? Amen. 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 So that was all the buildup, right? That was all the buildup so that we get back to Revelation 14 is where we left off. And I know it seems like this pause that we have seen here is kind of long, right? Because we just left the sixth trumpet, and it seems like we're just never getting to the seventh trumpet. And then finally, we get in the seventh trumpet, and then there's this pause, and there's all this detail and explanation. So in chapter 14, if you have read ahead, or if you have read before, or if you're reading now, you will find greater detail in chapter 14 about who the 144,000 are. So let's look and see. What does it say? Revelation 14, where we left off before, and we're learning now the greater detail about who the 144,000 include. What are their characteristics? Who are they? And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. You know, I don't know if to other people, you know, these distinctions are important. But to me, there's a difference between in and on. Okay, so here we see in. And that implies to me, if it's in your forehead, what's in your forehead? Your brain, right? If it's in your forehead, then this name is written in your forehead. The mark, the characteristics, right, of those who follow Christ are in your brain. I don't know. That's just my opinion. It's okay if you disagree. And I heard a voice from heaven, and as the voice of many waters and the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne and before the four beasts. And now these are the beasts of heaven, and they're described as beasts. Why? Because they're so awesome and terrible in their description. Remember, having all the eyes and the heads and, you know, all that sort of thing. So before the beasts and the elders, those 24 elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000, which were redeemed from the earth. So now we see these 144,000, remember, each 12,000 from the 12 tribes of Israel. And you don't have to be, we're not talking about, you know, hereditary genetics. We're not talking about, you know, that sort of thing. We're talking about the people of God, the people of Israel, those from the tribe. And we have been intermarried and intermingled, and there's no ability necessarily to determine by genetics. God will know you how because of that mark in your brain. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. So now we've learned something else about these 144. They're virgins. These are the, and virgins in how? You know, does this mean that they would have been existing forever without having relations with a woman? Well, it could mean that because it says, you know, they were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. But it also could mean a purity, right, that exists in spirit. So I don't know that we should get bound to that, except that we, in essence, should take the Bible for what it states. These are those which follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and the Lamb, the first fruits, because that's what it, you know, the Israelites, the 12 tribes, were the chosen, right? The first fruits. Those of us who come after them are the second, third, or fourth fruits. And fruits of what? The resulting fruit of the word being taught, following God, reading the word, studying the word. So we may not be the first fruits. We may be the second, third, fourth. I mean, however many years, right, have passed, over 2,000 from that time. So we're not the first fruits now. They were the first fruits. They were redeemed out of the earth, separated, set apart, much as we ought to be now, separated, set apart for a purpose unto God. And in their mouth was found no guile, verse 5, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Remember now, we talked about being perfection in God's eyes. So it's important that we see here, they were without fault before the throne of God, in God's eyes, right? They were able to appear with God and be separated, set apart in his presence. They're without fault or guile. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth. Now, recalling, these 144,000, right, are up with the Lord. They were, remember, as we read in, I think it was Revelation 7, I think it was, or maybe it was 6, but they were separated, right? They were set aside and up with, because we had the 24 elders first, and then the 144,000, right? And they received their white robes, and then the multitude came after them and received their white robes. So now there's another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that are what? That are dwelling on the earth. And now remember that this chapter 14 is happening. Because this is the increased definition, right? The increased description. But this is happening back when it first happened, right? It's like saying, describing the car accident, right? Well, the car accident may have occurred yesterday, but now when I'm talking to you about it, I'm giving you more details. But it still happened yesterday, right? So when we're thinking again about this 7-day week, a day for a year, the 7,000 or the 7 years during this regular tribulation, we found that the 144,000 were taken fairly quickly, right? In that explanation, set apart to be with the Lord. This is This is, again, that idea of the overlapping, right? We're adding layers and layers of details.